Hello everyone, my name is Ramya and I'm working as an assistant professor in the Department of Computer Engineering at AP Shah Institute of Technology. This session is being delivered as a part of the International FDP on Environment and Sustainability organized by D.Y. Patil College of Engineering, Akurdi, in association with the UNESCO Chair on Open Technologies for Open Educational Resources and Open Learning. In today's session, the topic that I am going to discuss is smart buildings, an Internet of Things approach towards sustainability. Now, before we begin the session, let's have a quick recap into what we discussed in week 1 and week 2 videos. In the week 1, we had discussed about how smart buildings, energy efficient offices, remote connection to farms, IoT air panel devices, industrial IoT and IoT in the construction and IoT enabled sensor platforms helps in achieving sustainability. We had also looked at how the key players, that is the government, industry and startup, works towards creating a vibrant IoT ecosystem in India. In the week 2 video, we had discussed the various ISO and IEEE standards governing IoT. Now let's have a look at the outcomes of today's session. The learning outcome number 1 of this session is that the students will be able to understand how the constructions and buildings result in energy wastage and leave huge carbon footprints, and how smart buildings are the need of the hour to achieve the 2030 goal of below 2 degree global average temperature rise as per the Paris Agreement. The second learning outcome of this session is to understand the concept of smart buildings, the technologies used to implement them and the various IEEE and ISO standards for establishing a vibrant IoT ecosystem. The third learning outcome is that the students will be able to demonstrate how carbon footprints are calculated for buildings, offices using the IBM TriRiga tool. Now let's have a quick round of look at the various IEEE and ISO standards. This is not an exhaustive list. I have listed out only a few of the prominent ones. First, let's have a look at the ISO standards. ISO IEC 21823 is a standard that provides an overview of interoperability. That means it acts as a framework for interoperability for IoT systems. The next prominent standard is ISO IEC 30141, which provides a reference architecture. That means basically it provides a common vocabulary, reusable designs and industry best practices that are to be followed when building IoT systems or services. The third standard is ISO IEC 27030, which relates to privacy and security. It also covers the aspect of trustworthiness when we are building or working with an IoT system, service or solution. So these are the prominent ISO standards. Now let's have a look at the IEEE standards. IEEE P2413 is a standard that provides an architectural framework for the IoT. So it basically covers the IoT domain abstractions and identification of common functionalities between different IoT domains. The next standard, that is IEEE 1451, focuses on harmonization of Internet of Things devices and systems. By harmonization, we basically are referring to data sharing, interoperability and security of the messages that we pass using sensors, actuators and other IoT devices. The next prominent standard is IEEE 2700. This standard provides a common framework for sensor performance specification, that is all the terminologies, units, conditions, limits, etc. related to sensors. Next standard is IEEE P2510. This standard defines the qualities, measures, controls, parameters, and definitions related to IoT implementations. So this was a quick look through the various ISO and IEEE standards governing IoT. Now let's understand why we require smart buildings. In order to achieve the goal set forth in the Paris Agreement, that is to limit our global average temperature rise to below 2 degrees Celsius, we need a 30% improvement in the global average building energy intensity, which is measured in terms of energy use per meter square. So we need a 30% improvement in the average building intensity in order to achieve this goal of below 2 degree global average temperature rise by 2030. Now the problem here is that in order to achieve this target, the number of high performance and low carbon buildings need to increase sixfold compared to what the current global trajectory is. That means near zero energy, zero emission buildings need to become the construction standard globally within the next decade so that we can achieve this goal of below 2 degree global average temperature rise by 2030. Similarly, regarding the existing buildings, we need to renovate them, and the rate of renovation need to be more than 2-3% per year in the coming decade. So this is exactly why we need to go towards smart buildings from our traditional building construction methodology. Now just have a look at this graph. This graph demonstrates the share of global final energy consumption by sector. This graph has been adapted from the UN Environmental Global Status Report of 2017. So you can see here buildings and the construction industry attribute to about 36% of the global final energy consumption. So you can see the split up here. Residential buildings contribute 22% and non-residential buildings contribute 8%. So 22 + 8, total 30% of the final energy consumption is attributed to this building sector and 6% to the construction industry. Look at this graph. So this graph basically shows that shows the global energy related CO2 emissions sector wise. This data is of 2015, and again it's adapted from the UN Environment Global Status Report of 2017. So you can see here buildings attribute to 28% of the global carbon emission and construction industry to 11% of the carbon emission, and the split up is given here. So that means 28 + 11, that means almost 40% of the global carbon emission is attributed to this building and construction industry sector. So I hope you are able to understand the scenario why we need to adopt smart buildings. We need to adopt smart buildings because the building and construction sector account for more than 35% of the global final energy use and nearly 40% of the energy related CO2 emissions. This is a great matter of concern. Now this map demonstrates the buildings sector energy carbon intensities country wise. This data is of 2015. So you can see here our country belongs to the red zone, that is it has greater than 150 tons CO2 emission per terajoule. So here 1 ton CO2 per terajoule is equivalent to 3.6 gram CO2 per kilowatt hour. So you can see how huge a number that is, and what a grave concern is the impact of building sector on the environment. Now let's understand what do we mean by a smart building. Any structure that uses automated processes to automatically control the building's operations, including the heating, ventilation, air conditioning, lighting, security and other aspects is said to be a smart building. So there are different technologies involved in this process. Smart buildings utilize efficient technologies like automated controls, network sensors, advanced metering systems, advanced building automation, data analytics software, energy management and information systems, monitoring systems, etc. for its implementation. So that is what is meant by a smart building. Now let's have a look at the elements or components which make up a smart building. The first component is HVAC systems. Now what is HVAC? HVAC stands for heating, ventilation and air conditioning systems. So now let's have a comparison of the HVAC systems in traditional buildings and the modern smart buildings. So in the modern smart buildings, HVAC systems can improve. So smart heating, ventilation and air conditioning systems use multiple sensors for monitoring and control. They also make use of certain software which interpret information from various sensor points and thereby optimize the HVAC system's operation, at the same time improving the occupants' comfort level also. So smart HVAC controls basically can limit the energy consumption in unoccupied building zones, detect and diagnose defaults and reduce the HVAC usage, particularly during the peak times of energy demand. So that is the first component. The next component is plug loads. Now what is a plug load? A plug load is the amount of energy drawn by a device that is plugged into an electrical outlet. So plug loads include the hundreds of different types of portable offers and miscellaneous equipments in buildings. In the existing buildings, smart plug load control consists of auto control receptacles and power strips which rely on time scheduling, motion sensing or load detection to completely cut off power to those equipments that are not in use. Now this can also be integrated into the building's lighting management system. This is what is meant by plug loads. The next component is lighting system. So smart lighting consists of advanced controls that incorporate day lighting and advanced occupancy and dimming functions to eliminate overlit spaces. And then basically depending on the occupancy of the room and based on demand response, programs can be built which can monitor and dim as per the requirements. So we can also integrate wireless capability into the lighting management systems for the same. The next component is window shading. Now what is window shading? By window shading we are referring to the smart window systems that manage the amount of solar heat and daylight that enters the building. So these systems consist of passive and active window glazing and films that respond to changes in sunlight or temperature, and auto control shades that are scheduled to operate at specific times of the day in order to control the light levels and solar heat gain. So in retrofit, smart shading technologies have the greatest energy savings potential in buildings with untinted single pane windows. The next component is automated system optimization. So here we are talking about a real-time feedback. In the traditional building automation system, it works based on preset schedules and set points, but the automated system optimization relies on real-time feedback. That means basically it uses some ICT technology to collect and analyze the building's operational and energy performance data and then make anticipatory changes in the operation based on external factors such as the occupancy pattern, weather forecast and utility rates. So cloud-based remote building monitoring is also growing in popularity. That's what's meant by automated system optimization. The next element is human operation. So by human operation, we are referring to those operators or specialists, IT specialists, who can interface with a smart building through computer dashboard. So computer dashboard means basically user-friendly interactive displays of the building operation and energy use. So these dashboards help the operating personnel or IT specialists to apply training in network management, data analysis and smart technology. So they can also work with these mobile apps to control some of the workspace functions. The next component is DERs, or Connected Distributed Generation and Power. So here we are basically talking about distributed energy resources. Distributed energy resources means those systems, energy generation and storage systems, which are placed at or near the point of use and provide power independent of the grid. That means independent of the existing power grid, we can make use of systems like combustion engines, fuel cells, solar photovoltaic cells, etc. to provide electricity. So this results in considerable energy savings when compared to using the traditional power grid alone. So these are some of the energy savings, or you can say the cost effectiveness of using smart buildings. Now smart buildings also result in lower greenhouse gas emissions. Let's have a look at the carbon emission or footprint calculation of smart buildings. I have used the IBM TriRiga tool for reference. So the IBM TriRiga Building Insight tool uses IoT and artificial intelligence to deliver actionable insights in order to help the building owners better understand and manage the occupancy and the performance of their facilities. So this is basically a cyclic process which involves 7 steps. Let's have a look at those steps. The first step is to trigger the carbon footprint calculation process. So every building or system must have this integrated in their environment. So the first step is trigger the carbon footprint calculation process. The second step is to retrieve the locations and organization with change. That is basically we are talking about retrieving all the inputs related to energy use and carbon footprints. And we have to perform the calculations. And once the calculations are done, we have to create the carbon log with all the input and output data. And this has to be updated in the, that is the current period carbon footprint has to be updated in the log. And then we reset the carbon calculation needed flag. So this process is to be done at regular intervals of time and the log updated continuously in order to get insights from the stored data and do necessary initiatives for saving energy and reducing the impact of carbon footprint, the organizations or buildings carbon footprint on the environment. So this is what is IBM's TriRiga tool. Now the IBM TriRiga tool incorporates different types of information for predicting the carbon footprint. Let's have a look at what are the information that the TriRiga tool collects. One is on-site energy production and information pertaining to other industrial activities. It also incorporates information related to the area, facilities and percentage of occupancy of the building. Facility energy such as gas, electricity, gas, coal, oil and solar energy. It also takes into account the information related to corporate travel such as bus, plane, rail, any vehicle for that matter. It also takes into consideration how the corporate waste are treated. So all this is taken into consideration for calculating the carbon footprint by the IBM TriRiga tool. Now let's have a look at the formulas that are used for calculating the carbon footprints. Given here is the carbon footprint calculation formula for energy. So this is adapted from the IBM TriRiga carbon footprint calculation process. So you can see here the formulas for calculating the direct energy emission which falls under scope 1. So you can see how different greenhouse gases, that is CO2, CH4 and N2O emission amount is calculated using these formulas. For instance, the emission of CO2 is calculated by multiplying the total amount into the CO2 emission factor into heating value into density of that particular appliance. Same way, the formula for the scope 2, that is indirect energy emissions, is also given here. Now let's have a look at how the carbon footprint calculation is done for travel. So this travel information is classified into three categories. The scope 1 is direct travel emission, that means by those vehicles that are owned by the company. Scope 2 is direct travel emissions for vehicles that are not owned by the company. And scope 3 is indirect travel emissions for vehicles that are owned by the company. So using these formulas, we can calculate the carbon emission of travel and then calculate the total carbon footprint. The third category is carbon footprint calculation for other emissions within the organization premises. Now let's have a look at the sustainability computation or standards. Now, since I'm not having any real-time data of a smart building, I have restricted my session to showing the computational formulas, but I've taken a case study for showing you the sustainability advantages of a smart building. I have taken into consideration the case study of smart buildings done by ACEEE, which is basically a case study of the smart buildings in North America performed by ACEEE. So according to that report, you can see here the energy savings accounted to smart buildings. So based on the building type, that is in which sector it is utilized, education, office, hotel, laboratory or hospital, you can see there is significant energy savings when we adopt a smart building from the traditional building. So you can see here in the case of education sector, that means if it is an educational institution with a floor area of 1 lakh square feet, the use of smart building technology results in an average energy consumption of 1,90,000 kilowatt hour per year, and it results in a percentage energy savings by 11% when you compare it with a traditional institution without a smart building. That means by average it is about 20,900 kilowatt per hour per year which is actually saved. So that is really a huge number. So the information for different type of smart buildings is listed out in this table. So what you have to understand is that we urgently need to move towards a pollution free and sustainable planet. And so technologically and commercially viable solutions are there. What we need is stronger policies, implementation and partnership among consumers and different organizations. So the IoT and ICT technology has a very significant role to play in reducing greenhouse gas emissions, especially in developing countries like India. So the industries, offices and organizations should make use of modern ICT and IoT technologies to move into a higher efficiency and lower carbon market. So that is the gist of today's presentation. Now, according to sources, the smart building technology could potentially reduce emission by 1.68 gigaton CO2, and that is almost worth $295 billion of energy savings and $45.7 billion in carbon costs in existing and new buildings. So these are the papers which I've referred for preparing the presentation content. Thank you.